So we have already seen what does mutation, what are the different kinds of mutations in detail in the previous presentations. And here we'll be looking into the importance of mutations in evolution. Evolutionary changes are based upon genetic variations and changes in the genetic frequency. The ultimate source of all genetic variations is mutation. Whether the mutation is produced by changes in the molecular structure and arrangement of genes, or whether it is produced by the change in the number of chromosomes. So whatever it is, the ultimate source is mutation. And its importance in evolution was first stressed by William Bateson in England in 1894 and Hugo de Vries in Holland in 1901. And they described mutations as discontinuous variations producing easily recognizable changes, but very important ones. De Vries, in his mutation theory, argued that the building blocks of evolutionary changes are such large and abrupt heritable variations or mutations rather than gradual accumulation of small variations. Actually, Darwin proposed that these heritable variations, especially by the gradual accumulation of smaller variations, was responsible for the evolutionary changes. But as per mutation theory by de Vries, evolutionary changes are brought about by large, abrupt heritable variations. And these spontaneous heritable variations are what are referred as a mutations. Okay. De Vries based his theory on the studies conducted on Enothera lamarckiana, that is evening primrose, and he believed that some of his mutants were new species. That is, during the studies, whatever variations were developed, that is, the mutants formed, were new species produced in a single step. But later studies showed that the mutants described by de Vries were due to a variety of heritable changes, particularly chromosomal aberrations. So Richard Goldschmidt in 1940 shared the view that species arise not by gradual divergence, but rather by spontaneous changes, abrupt changes. Right? Mutations are hence considered as raw materials of evolution. The modern concept of mutation is due to the work by T.H. Morgan, Thomas Hunt Morgan, on Drosophila melanogaster. I hope you are very familiar with Drosophila melanogaster. It is a fruit fly. Okay. Mutations were defined as changes in a single gene with effects ranging from barely detectable to very drastic changes. Okay. All these are like this much range of changes are being referred by the term mutation. In 1910, Morgan discovered many spontaneous gene mutations in Drosophila, such as white eyes, yellow body color, etc. The normal eye color is red eye, while the what you call spontaneous due to spontaneous gene mutations, white-eyed Drosophila came into being. Okay. And in his book, The Scientific Basis of Evolution, Morgan regarded mutations as the only significant factor capable of bringing about evolutionary changes, including the origin of more complex organisms. So he also, in 1972, he also discovered that the frequency of mutation could be increased in the progenies of flies treated with X-rays. So he conducted experiments, and the results showed that it could be induced and the frequency can be increased. And other factors like high energy radiations, chemicals like mustard gas, even high temperatures can also cause mutations, right? Several insect species, for example, have survived in areas where widespread use of insecticides like DDT killed off most of their members in the species, because a few surviving members had or developed an immunity to the insecticide by mutation. And from these small population of survivors, the species were able to build up its members again. That is, by the application of DDT, the insect population came down to so a small number. But these small number of individuals remaining were resistant to DDT. And from these survivors, the species were able to build up the population again. Another example of differential survival is given by darkly pigmented peppered moth, or the Biston vitularia. Okay, a typical example of industrial melanism, and it was studied and published by Bernard Kittlewell in 1961. You can see in this particular figure, this is Biston Betularia. Okay, you can see a moth, I hope. Okay, here there is a moth. This is same species, but you can see it is such a variant forms, isn't it? One is completely black color, dark colored, and here you can see the typical gray color. Okay, this is a typical example of spontaneous mutations, and it is referred as industrial melanism. Okay, I hope it is clear here, industrial melanism, right? And this was actually studied in the industrial, after industrial revolution this happened, and this actually was studied in England. Kettlewell was from England. So the peppered moth was common in England, and it appeared in two forms, okay, the light or the non-melanic forms, and dark or melanic forms. Melanic forms, they are referred as carbonaria as well, okay. The normal light forms of the moth is spotted white. You can see here, okay, they are white with spots on them, and this is due to the absence of melanin pigments in the body. While dark forms, you can see in over here on the right side, it was because they had melanin pigments. Kettlewell conducted an extensive survey on the relative abundance and distribution of the normal light colored moth as well as the melanic forms of peppered moth in different parts of Britain. Okay, so this is Britain, and he studied the distribution of the two different kinds of moth in Britain, and he found that light forms were found in abundance in unpolluted countryside such as north of Scotland and such kind of areas, where they reached even 100%. In certain areas they were only, so for example over here you can see, okay, it is only the light colored moth, okay, here majority is light colored, okay, so towards the those areas which have like unpolluted countrysides, peppered moth was light colored, peppered moth were abundant, while here they were found on tree trunks covered with lichens. Okay, I hope you know what are lichens. Okay, and when lichens grow on tree trunks, it was hard for the predators to see, when these peppered moth sat or perched on the lichen covered branches or tree trunks, what happens is the predators were found it difficult to find them. Okay, it was almost camouflaging. The light forms escaped death in unpolluted areas. On the other hand, dark forms or the melanic forms were abundant in industrial areas. You can see in some areas it is completely melanic forms over here in this part, isn't it? These are the industrial areas, and it was observed that these melanic forms were abundant in industrial areas like Manchester and Birmingham. And here the lichens were killed and the tree trunks were blackened because of the pollution from the industrial soot and other waste. That is the waste, that what you call dark colored gaseous particles which were released from the industry, they covered the tree trunks. So what happened? It became darker, and to suit that, the melanic forms were abundant. So hence the dark forms became invisible to the predators against the blackened background of the tree trunks in these areas. Thus they escaped death while light forms were picked up by the birds. So in other words, black color became an adaptive device in industrial areas, and hence natural selection favored dark moths over light forms in these areas. It was just the opposite in the other, in unpolluted areas, where the dark forms were easily picked up by the birds, because it was lichen covered tree trunks upon which these particular moths sat, isn't it? So it was easily visible for the birds to prey upon, so that the frequency of light forms were higher in such areas. In each case, the differential mortality, that is difference in the death rate, okay, which was achieved by selective predation. I hope it is clear. Okay, the change from light to dark color in the industrial areas of England thus provides an excellent example of natural selection favoring darker moths which match the background. And this phenomenon is referred as the industrial melanism, as the spread of melanic form corresponds with the spread of industrialization in England. So here you can see there is a dominant gene of melanism increased in frequency, and hence more and more black peppered or melanic forms appear. So this is actually the studies or observations made by Kettlewell. Okay, I hope this one is clear. Okay, industrial melanism and the contribution by Bernard Kettlewell. Right. Now, the mutations, when we speak about the mutations back here, sorry, the mutations as per Richard Goldschmidt, there are two kinds. Some mutations, they produce variations among individuals, modifying their adaptations to environment. And these mutations are referred as micromutations, because it takes place by accumulation of smaller changes, that is changes according to the changing environment, right? Changes that help the individuals to adapt to the changing environment. So these are known as micromutations. While other mutations produce like new species, genera or families, and those were known as macromutations. I hope it is clear. Micromutations and macromutations. Micromutations lead to microevolution, while macromutations lead to macroevolution. Okay, so macromutations, it is otherwise known as systemic mutations, and lead to the evolution of species or genera, and perhaps even higher categories. And that is why it is referred as a macroevolution. And macroevolution operates above the species level and results in the establishment of new genera, families, and sometimes even orders by large, sudden, spontaneous, rapid mutations. Okay, those are known as macromutations. I hope it is clear. Okay, so this is about the what you call the mutations in the role of mutations in evolution. Thank you.